Hello everybody, I'm Nick, and in this video I'm going to show you a brand new feature coming in C# 12 called Inline Arrays. Now, I want to be very clear with this video, you are probably not going to even know you are using this, because this is one of those features that Microsoft basically needs something on their end, and they add it into C# and would just get to use it because they need it. It is very unlikely you are going to create your own inline arrays unless you're doing some very niche high performance stuff. However, because you will be consuming them as Microsoft start creating more and more in .NET for themselves, I thought I would make this video to explain what this feature is, how it works, and why you ultimately will end up using it. If you like our content and you want to see more, make sure you subscribe, and for more training, check out my courses on domtrain.com. Right, let me show you what I have here. I have this console application over here. It doesn't really have anything, and it is in .NET 8, and I'm using Visual Studio because this Visual Studio preview supports the feature. That's basically it. Now, if I were to create an array in C#, I would do something like this. I would first declare my array and probably have a fixed size if I know that this array only needs 10 items, for example. Then I can write something like this to populate the array. So I'm just going to loop around 10 elements and I'm going to use I as the parameter, use the index and set the value. And if I wanted to print, I can either use a for loop or a for each loop, and I would end up with something like this. So if I was to run this, what I would get is a sequence from 0 all the way to 9. Pretty basic stuff. Now, first, an array is a reference type, meaning that this will be actually allocated on the heap, which is the garbage collectible side of the memory. It's not a stack allocated value in here. Now, this in itself is not a bad thing, because if you want to do some high performance processing, you could always still have an array, but actually convert it, let's say, to something like a span. So you can do span of integers and interface with it through the span struct. And because the span is a ref struct, there won't be an allocation when you work on it. However, this original allocation of the array is still here, and it's actually pretty inefficient for something like this. So C# 12 adds the following. I'm going to go ahead and create a new type, and I'm going to call this item just my array. So my special array will be represented with this new type. Now, the way to convert this type into an inline array is a bit interesting, and depending on who you ask, again, sort of a weird thing. Let me show you. First, this should be a struct, and by being a struct, it's a value type. We can actually prevent some allocations. Now, if I want, I can have a generic t-type parameter here to allow any type to be passed into this inline array. Then what I want to have is I want to slap an inline array attribute here, and I want to specify a fixed size. So in this case, if I want to match what I had before, I'm going to say that this is 10. And I'm going to go ahead and import system.runtime.compilerservices. So once I have that, I must declare in here, and that's why I have a compilation error, one and only one instance field. And that's where the clunkiness actually, in my opinion, comes in. So what I need to do is say private t, and then just say element 0. The name doesn't really matter. And that's it. Now I have an inline array. Now you might be wondering, this is a private field that nothing is going to refer to. So what the hell? Well, yeah, that's because the compiler will actually use that. You won't use it. So on the front end, if you want to convert this to go from using a traditional array to use an inline array, what you want to say is new my array of type, in this case integer, because that's what I had, and that is it. And as you can see, this whole code compiles. So I have my array, which is a struct, and it has this magic field in here, which, by the way, if I remove, I won't be able to compile. It has the fixed size of 10, and then I can iterate to set a value, and I can also iterate to print the value. And in fact, if I do that, you can see in the console nothing changed functionality wise. I still have the same thing. However, what did change is that now this is allowed to be allocated on the stack. So I'm going to save this allocation. Now, if you've ever worked or are familiar with C, this actually might ring a bell. Ultimately, what Microsoft is trying to create here is fixed size buffers. Something like this has many benefits, but one of the main reasonings behind why Microsoft is doing it is so they can interface with unmanaged APIs. What is going to happen behind the scenes is that Microsoft will start using those for their own benefit, and you're going to be able to interface and use them. Of course, the idea is that something like this will actually be convertible to a span of that type. So that would allow you to use the more feature-rich span API to interface with your inline array, but directly the behavior might be a bit limited. Now, since I've mentioned performance quite a few times already, let's actually visualize how much different a traditional array and an inline array would be performance-wise. So I'm going to use the exact same array over here and write some benchmarks. Now, in terms of benchmarks, I'm going to start with these two. So what I'm going to do is use a memory diagnoser to see what impact the memory has between the two types. And I'm going to actually go ahead and change my array to have a size of 100. So we're going to see with up to 100 items, what's the difference. If I go back to the benchmark, you can see I'm using a seed over here in my randomizer. So both tests will actually generate the same data every time I run them, so we can have an equal comparison. Now, in terms of this benchmark, all I'm doing is I'm creating an array or an inline array, and then I'm populating all the items with a random value. So I'm going to go to the program.cs, return early over here, and say benchmark runner and run my benchmarks. So back to the console, I'm going to say .NET run in release mode, and let's see what we get for these two very basic benchmarks. So that was quick, and results are back. And as you can see here, we have the create array, the one creating a traditional array, to run in 540 nanoseconds, but we have half a kilobyte of memory almost allocated, while the inline array doesn't have any memory, and it does perform just a little faster, but this doesn't really matter, but the memory thing is actually pretty interesting. Now, you might be thinking, okay, couldn't I just do the same thing with a span? Well, kind of, but not really, because if you use a span, you have to use stack alloc, and if you use stack alloc, you can't always allocate everything on the stack. So by having it in a struct, which could also be allocated on the heap, you have a bit more flexibility. By the way, if you try to do something like convert this into a ref struct, you won't get a compilation error here in the preview, but if I try to run it, it will actually not run. I don't know if they're going to add it, but if they do add it, what's going to happen is by using a ref struct over here, you don't allow this to physically be able to be allocated on the heap, which will give it properties similar to span. But creation is one thing. What about retrieval? Well, to test that, I'm going to bring in two pre-populated arrays, and I'm going to pre-populate them with the exact same data. Then I'm going to use a global setup and reset the same seed twice, so I'm sure that both of them end up with the same values. Once I have these two things in place, I'm going to say, hey, get inline array data and get array data, and then as you're retrieving them, create a sum of all the values in there into this long, just to have some logic so nothing is just removed or optimized away. So I'm going to go ahead here, reset this, and rerun it, and see where we are. All right, the results are back, and as you can see over here, the get array, the traditional heap allocated array, 46 nanoseconds. However, the inline array is even faster, and in both cases, because we're dealing with integers, nothing is being allocated on the heap, so zero allocations. Again, very niche feature. You're probably not going to create one of these for yourself, but if anything I said in this video rings a bell and says I could use this, well then know that this is coming in C# 12. As always, with all the new features, I'm going to link the proposal down below in the description. So if you want to click on it, try it out, just offer some feedback to Microsoft. That's why I make these videos. So please do. We can actually steer the direction of .NET quite a bit. But what do you think? Because one of the most interesting discussions I had with people about C# features is that Microsoft is focusing too much on features they need, not features we need. So I want to know your thoughts about that. Well, that's all I had for you for this video. Thank you very much for watching, and as always, keep coding.